guys, and welcome back once again to my Who Is / Who Was series on my channel, where I look at all the different actors that have played the character of the Doctor over the last 50 years by looking at the Doctor's Who's Who book right here and reading samples out of that and talking about my own opinions and my own thoughts on the various different actors. So we've already gone through William Hartnell and Patrick Troughton, and now it's time for the third Doctor, who of course was Jon Pertwee. Patrick Troughton and William Hartnell, Jon Pertwee was one of the great British character actors of the 20th century. His ability to throw his voice and adopt a multitude of characters made him a man in high demand, especially on radio in the 1950s and 60s. He was incredibly versatile and as much in demand as Kenneth Williams, or indeed his character acting cousin Bill Pertwee, who later played Hodges in Dad's Army. He was educated at Frensham High School at Rowledge at Sherborne School at Sherborne in Dorset. He was the son of the famous playwright, novelist and actor Roland Pertwee. Roland's friend Henry Ainley was Jon Pertwee's godfather. His son Anthony Ainley would become an actor and play alongside Jon in The Five Doctors as the Master, while Anthony's brother Richard Ainley would become Tom Baker's drama teacher while he was coached as an amateur by William Hartnell. Jon's dad was also good friends with A.A. Milne, and Jon was invited to tea one afternoon where he met Milne's son Christopher Robin. After tea, Christopher took Jon upstairs where he was introduced to the boys' toy animals, Piglet, Owl, Kanga, Roo and Christopher's favourite, Winnie the Pooh. Jon was also allowed to ride on Christopher Robin's donkey, Eeyore. Despite having a famous father and interesting acquaintances, Pertwee's upbringing was not a happy one. For a start, he didn't see his mother until he was 15. She had had an affair when Pertwee was an infant and his father kicked her out of the marital home. She moved away with her lover, and Pertwee and his elder brother Michael were left with a father who was neatly wrapped up in his own world, with little time for them. The three boys were close brothers, but if anyone got left out, it would be Jon. Jon spent much of his formative years under the care of his uncle Guy, but he was also very close to his grandmother, who helped to look after him. Despite feeling left out by his father, Pertwee didn't think of any other career but acting. Laurence Olivier was one of Pertwee's early acquaintances. Towards the end of his life, Pertwee used to quote a true story that proved Olivier was indeed the greatest actor that ever lived. He explained that one day he was invited to a party while Olivier was visiting his house. He asked the actor to accompany him, but Olivier wasn't keen. Pertwee refused to take no for an answer, and begrudgingly, Olivier went along. Once at the party, Pertwee sat Olivier down with a sandwich and some tea. Believing that he would be alright, Pertwee left him alone. He then explained that Olivier hated anyone creeping up behind him, but unfortunately, somebody did. An old lady came up behind him on the sofa, put her hands over his eyes and said, "Guess who?" Olivier shot up in the air and the poor woman was propelled backwards over a chair. An enraged Olivier stormed over to the host and demanded, "Who was that woman?" The host replied, "That was my wife." Seamlessly, Olivier declared, "What an extraordinary woman." Acting was the family business, so Pertwee took it for granted that he would follow in his father's footsteps. In fact, Jon had four great aunts, the Moore sisters, who were also on stage. He always explained in interviews later that this complacency led him to always joking with the cast between takes to many a director's disdain. However, it didn't start out that way. At boarding school, there was a shortage of young lads who wanted to become actors. His peers considered him a pufter, so he was picked on for a while. It wasn't all doom and gloom though. When he was old enough to drive, Pertwee bought a 250cc SOS Trials motorbike and went for a ride. At a T-junction he lost control, went over a wall and into a vicar's garden. "Well done," the vicar said, "you're just in time for tea." So acting and fast bikes were part of his teenage makeup, and neither ever left him. Some people look upon the above story as a joke, but in fact it wasn't. Pertwee did indeed fly into the garden and was offered tea. Years later, the actor was passing the very same place with his son Sean and showed him the spot where he hit the wall because it had never been repaired. Pertwee joined RADA at aged 18, where he trained alongside Duncan Lamont, who would appear alongside John in the Doctor Who story Death to the Daleks. John's time at RADA came to an end when he was expelled for refusing to play the part of a Greek wind in a production. This caused a bit of embarrassment for his father, as he was one of the school governors. He then spent some time, while still at school, at a travelling circus riding the Wall of Death, which he maintained was very easy to do. What wasn't easy to do, and something he of course refused to do, was to put a real life lion in the act with him. Because the circus had a very old, toothless lion, they thought it would be good for Pertwee to take it for a spin on the Wall of Death. A preposterous idea, but it was suggested. The rest of the 30s saw Pertwee working in a travelling theatre company and the occasional stint on radio, which gave him a lot of experience as an actor. Much of Pertwee's output from the 30s and 40s is now lost. Programmes were performed live and too few were recorded on 78 RPM records. At one stage, Pertwee was performing 15-minute stints on radio every day for months on end. This made him quite wealthy, but sadly, there are only a smattering of examples of his work preserved today. What we do know of Pertwee's early career is that his father helped him. One of Pertwee's early theatre runs was in To Kill a Cat, which his father wrote. Also, in 1939 movie The Four Just Men was scripted by his father, who also took a small part in it. The movie also had an added distinction of being the first in which Pertwee actually spoke. Speed was still a passion of Pertwee's, despite his growing popularity as an actor, and he competed at Goodwood for the odd motor car engagement right up to the outbreak of the Second World War. He then joined the Royal Naval Volunteer Reserve, RNVR, and became an officer. Like Patrick Troughton, he too escaped death at sea. Pertwee was one of a small group of people who got transferred from HMS Hood shortly before it was destroyed in under 10 seconds by the Bismarck. 1,762 men went down in one bang, he told Michael Parkinson in 1982. It was a very lucky escape on that occasion, and he experienced several other close calls with death during the war. Another little known episode from Pertwee's war was his tattoo. He recalled in interviews that one day he had a run ashore, a naval term for having a good drink on land. Got extremely drunk and woke up with a large tattoo on his right forearm. He remembered nothing about having it done. It can be seen in several moments of his time on Doctor Who, including his very first spearhead from space. And when he was asked to roll his sleeve up for an injection in his second serial, The Silurians, he chooses the left arm, keeping his souvenir of a drunken night out well hidden. Pertwee and Troughton met several times during the war years, as he told Peter Haining. Troughton had a strong dislike of the standard issue tin hat that the Navy made the people on the motor torpedo boats wear, so instead he wore this old family tea cosy on his head. It was a gaudy looking thing and must have annoyed his commanding officer no end, but he still went on wearing it, Pertwee said. Troughton would wear a tea cosy hat while playing the Doctor in such sea-based stories as Fury from the Deep, and for him it became normal seagoing apparel. But Troughton wasn't the only eccentric would-be actor that Pertwee met during the war. There was also Robert Newton, a legendary character in the Royal Navy, always managing to acquire quality booze and disappearing to drink it and then sleep it off. Pertwee admired the man, especially in how he managed to get away with his insubordination. Newton was, like Pertwee, also expelled from RADA. However, he was eventually arrested and punished by the Royal Navy, who sent him on a trawler. But even then he managed to delay the ship's departure in order to acquire smoked salmon sandwiches and quality booze, so he and the crew could enjoy a good meal on the ocean waves. A little appreciated episode in Pertwee's war was when he was transferred to the Naval Intelligence Department, NID, in Whitehall. Towards the end of his life, Pertwee taught his one-man show, An Evening with Jon Pertwee, in which he briefly mentioned his tour in NID, but no real detail about the job. NID was actually the department where Ian Fleming, the man who would write James Bond, worked. Towards the end of his career in the Navy, Pertwee joined the broadcasting section where he met Lieutenant Eric Baker and seriously began his career in radio. This led to two series that made him a household name, Waterlogged Spa and The Navy Lark. He took on many trademark voices in the latter show, including an eccentric postman that endeared him to the nation with the catchphrases, "It doesn't matter what you do, as long as you tears them up," referring to people's letters. For a while, Pertwee worked alongside another great mimic in the Navy Lark, Ronnie Barker, who played Fatso Johnson in the show. Pertwee and Barker became firm friends. Barker later said of Pertwee, "John was always such fun to work with. We had a lot of laughs and he was always one of the prime instigators. But he was very professional and very talented, and I thoroughly enjoyed working with him. When Barker left and Pertwee was asked who they should put in his place to do other voices he'd done so well, he suggested himself and went on to do over 100 different voices for the show in the end. The Navy Light ran for 18 years, making it the longest running comedy show in the world at that time, only to be surpassed later by the news headlines. But it wasn't the only success that Pertwee worked on during that time. He also appeared in the theatre alongside Frankie Howard in The Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, which Howard continued to have great success with on TV. Pertwee's first starring role in a film was in Will Any Gentleman in 1953, coincidentally alongside William Hartnell, but that wasn't the only Doctor Who tie-in that came from the movie. During filming, Pertwee met Jean Marsh, whom he later married on 2nd of April 1955. Jean would become William Hartnell's companion in the longest Doctor Who story ever, The Dalek Master Plan, which went on for 12 episodes. Unfortunately, she was killed towards the end of the story, and, sadly, her marriage to Pertwee didn't last long either. They separated in 1958 before divorcing in 1960. Pertwee remarried shortly afterwards to a German lady he had met on a skiing holiday, Ingeborg Rosa. They married on 13th of August 1960 and had two children, Sean and Daryl. Pertwee's career as a character actor continued on radio, television and films throughout the 1950s and 60s. Indeed, there were some forgotten gems such as The Ugly Duckling, starring Bernard Breslau as Henry Jekyll and Teddy Hyde, with character actor David Lodge putting in an appearance too. On Sunday, 1st of November 1964, Pertwee appeared in the British Forces Broadcasting Service 21st Anniversary Gala Night at the Victoria Palace Theatre in London. Although Pertwee appeared alongside such people as Ken Dodd, Jimmy Edwards, Charlie Chester, Larry Adler, Ted Ray and Tommy Trinder, to name but a few, the ultimate stars of the show were the Goons, Spike Milligan, Peter Sellers and Harry Secom, who performed a whole episode of their madcap but groundbreaking show. Pertwee was a friend of both Sellers and Milligan, but in later life he would fall out with Spike over who was the bigger fan of the pantomime Aladdin. It was occasions such as the BFBS Gala Night where Pertwee was in his element, surrounded by talented, like-minded people who, despite some dreadful experiences during the war, took a comedic influence from those troubled times and shaped the face of British comedy for the next 50 years. Several years after the BFBS Gala Night, while playing on Broadway in There's a Girl in My Soup, Pertwee was offered the lead role in a brand new BBC comedy series. The leading role was written with his comic talents in mind. The role was Captain Mannering, the show Dad's Army. Pertwee turned down the part, and it went to Arthur Lowe, of course, whose interpretation would become legendary. Pertwee later said that he didn't really know what he was being offered back home at the time, that he was too wrapped up in the part he was playing. Suffice to say, if he had taken the part, he most certainly wouldn't have gone on to start in Doctor Who. Pertwee wasn't sore about losing out on Dad's Army. He knew that he wouldn't have had the opportunity of being the Doctor if he had taken the role, and he also found Arthur Lowe's interpretation of the part hysterical. In 1970, while filming horror spoof The House That Dripped Blood in 1971, fellow actor Christopher Lee wanted to know who Pertwee was sending up in his on-screen characterisation. The horror actor told Pertwee that some of his characteristics seemed familiar, but he couldn't put a name to who it was. Pertwee told Lee that he was actually sending him up. Lee found this hysterical. However, the director of the movie cut out much of the fun, and the film received indifferent notices as a consequence. While recording The Navy Like in 1969, Pertwee had a conversation about Doctor Who with Tenniel Evans, who would later play Major Daly in Jon's Doctor Who adventure Carnival of Monsters. Evans told him that there was a rumour that Patrick Troughton was leaving the show, and that he was ideal for the part. Pertwee was interested enough to call his agent, who, although unconvinced that he was the right man for the part, contacted the BBC to see what the situation was. He found that Pertwee was on the shortlist of actors to take over from Troughton, and had been for some time. Pertwee was offered the job. He accepted, and only then were the problems concerning his interpretation of the lead part. The BBC wanted Pertwee's Doctor to be a bit of a joke-telling minstrel to begin with, building further upon the Pied Piper-like antics of Patrick Troughton. However, Pertwee said that although his children enjoyed watching Troughton, he thought his friend had gone a little over the top. Pertwee was keen to play the part straight and bring in some real science. He also wanted to incorporate fast cars, powerboats, motorbikes and Aikido. After long conversations with producer Peter Bryant, Pertwee got his way, and not only did he make the transition from black and white to colour, but also attracted a more adult audience into the bargain. In truth, it wasn't as easy as all that. It was director Barry Letts who told Pertwee to play the role straight, as himself. And this presented problems to the actor because he didn't know who he really was. When his wife started to get him to do various things around the house, he discovered a love for anything mechanical and risk-taking, which brought him a deeper understanding of the type of thing he most enjoyed doing and, consequently, a greater understanding of himself. It is true that Pertwee brought in some humorous moments for the younger viewers, but there was always a very serious side to his personality too. Just as in life, Pertwee's doctor didn't suffer fools gladly. He despised ignorance and wanton destruction, displaying a heart on his sleeve need to always do the right thing. He was constantly at odds with the Brigadier who always wanted to blow things up. So, at the turn of the 1970s, Doctor Who took a major jump away from its roots, not just from the black and white children's classic to colour family entertainment, but also by his explaining where the Doctor came from, his planet, and his people. Although Pertwee's Doctor would be earthbound for some time, the mystery of where he came from was explained, albeit having its roots in the last ever Patrick Troughton story, The War Games. He was a Time Lord from the planet Gallifrey, who had his appearance changed and was exiled to Earth because he stole the TARDIS and roamed through time and space as a maverick. Soon a fellow Time Lord would become a regular cast member, to be the Professor Moriarty character to the Dr. Sherlock Holmes. The character was called the Master and was played by the excellent seasoned actor Roger Delgado. With his devil's beard, Mediterranean good looks and stern eyes, Delgado was a perfect balance to Pertwee's flamboyance. All of this was a brave move by the BBC. They were destroying the romantic unknown past of the Doctor, which must have been a great gamble on their part. They were explaining the Who in Doctor Who. Would they get away with such a thing? Surely that was an important ingredient in making the show successful, to keeping the audience guessing. There were many changes imposed by Pertwee's Doctor, which then seemed radical but are largely taken for granted today. Nowadays we are used to the Doctor running everywhere and using many gadgets, but it was Pertwee who really started all that off with his dashing interpretation of the title role. His was the James Bond Doctor, but there was no falseness with his interpretation. Also, Pertwee's love of character acting is sprinkled throughout Doctor Who. In some memorable scenes in the story The Green Death, he not only disguises himself as a Welsh milkman in order to get into a high security establishment, but also as a cleaning woman. They are wonderfully comic moments from an actor who established himself with wonderful comic voices on the radio. Although it is interesting to note that in a scene from an earlier Doctor Who episode where he provided a voice for a radio broadcast, it was later re-recorded by another actor because his voice was so recognisable. The Green Death was significant for another reason too. It provided the first fragrance of romance between the Doctor and one of his companions, Joe Grant, played so lovingly by Katie Manning. Joe falls in love with a hip young Welsh scientist and decides to leave the Doctor and go up the Amazon and get married. The Doctor attends the happy couple's leaving celebrations, but he is clearly upset at losing Joe, whom he always had a soft spot for. The final scene sees the Doctor sneaking out of the party and in silhouette driving his beloved car Bessie away. Katie Manning has fond memories of Pertwee, who really took her under his wing whilst filming the show, and this affection really comes across in every scene they play together. Pertwee enjoyed the more serious storyline, which complemented his interpretation of the Doctor perfectly. He loved the odd pretentious moment too, such as passing comment on a manor house wine cellar while waiting for a ghost to turn up in Day of the Daleks. But where Pertwee really succeeded was when he was allowed to get cross at interplanetary narrow-mindedness. Then he was in his element. His most serious scenes balanced his more comic ones, so much so that when Tom Baker first took over the role, some young fans found the lack of seriousness an issue. It is interesting how most of the actors up to Peter Davison were passionate about the underlying messages in the scripts and how they could be translated in a positive way to the younger viewers amidst the action, monsters and the ever-building mythology of the show. The basic theme of good transcending evil has always prevailed in Doctor Who, and the Doctor has been a very enigmatic character as a result. To a degree, we can thank William Hartnell for laying down some ground rules here. Returning to Pertwee, it is no surprise that his favourite story was Frontier in Space, and Draconians, creatures from the same story, his favourite foe. This story started off with epic aspirations, being part of a 12-episode space war story that took the Daleks into the kind of mega-scale story they enjoy in the new series today. Alas, the epic didn't really come off, but what fans reflect upon and enjoy today are two quality classic stories with a continuity thread from the end of one to the beginning of the other, The Planet of the Daleks. The first story said farewell to Roger Delgado's master, although not intentionally. Shortly after filming the story, Delgado went to Turkey to do some filming for his first comedy film role, the never-released Bell of Tibet. Unfortunately, he was killed in a car accident through no fault of his own. When Pertwee heard of his friend's death, he was terribly upset and did all he could to try to get some compensation from Delgado's wife, Kismet. No matter how hard he tried, he couldn't do it. He was appalled and realised how much he had taken his life into his own hands by playing with so many cars, bikes and powerboats throughout his life. The impact on the show was catastrophic as well, depriving the Doctor of what was planned to be a grand showdown with the Master, where it would be revealed what relationship they truly had with each other, the consensus of opinion being that they were brothers. When Pertwee heard that Barry Letts and Terence Dix were leaving the show soon afterwards, he decided that it was perhaps time for him to leave too. The team had really been broken up, especially with Delgado gone. Head of drama Sean Sutton quickly stepped in to ask if he would reconsider, which he did. Pertwee agreed to do two further seasons of Doctor Who if the BBC would increase his salary. Pertwee was shocked when Sutton shook his hand and said, "Thanks for everything, sorry to see you go." There were no negotiations at all. Pertwee was out of a job. He felt hurt, but was told that there was no flexibility in the budget, so that was it. Ever the professional, Pertwee shot the stories that would complete his current season with equal vigour as his earlier episodes. The next story after his regeneration was The Dinosaur Invasion. This story introduced the Doctor's space-age flying car, the Whomobile, which he even drove through Piccadilly Circus one fine day, to the London Police Force's horror. During his last season as the Doctor, Pertwee received a touching letter from a mother of a little girl who was a big fan. The mother explained that the girl was going through a tough time and was emotionally disturbed. Pertwee wrote to the little girl and sent her a signed photo. The change in the girl's behaviour was amazing. She took the photo of Pertwee everywhere with her. It was comforting for her. The mother and daughter both kept in touch with Pertwee for many years, and when the little girl grew up and had two children of her own, Pertwee became their godfather. Halfway through recording Planet of the Spiders, his last Doctor Who adventure, Pertwee filmed his regeneration scene. He lay still on the floor for what appeared to be an extremely long time, to be replaced by, changed into, Tom Baker. Many of the cast and crew said that Pertwee was a different man afterwards. He didn't join in with the jokes on set, but took himself away to read and reply to his fan mail instead. Although ever the professional on screen, Pertwee knew he was at the end of his time as a Doctor, and was doing nothing more than preparing himself to move on. He had no idea at the time that the part would never leave him. For all the best reasons, he really thought it was the end at the time. Like his predecessors, he didn't entirely want to go, but knew it was the right thing to do for his career. When asked years later by Terry Wogan if he missed the Doctor, Pertwee said, "I miss Doctor Who from time to time, but I enjoy Wurzel too." And of course Pertwee had another enormous success following Doctor Who, Wurzel Gummidge. Based on the novels by Barbara Youth and Todd, Pertwee took a country accent and much makeup to become the eccentric scarecrow of Scatterbrook Farm and won the hearts of children all over again. Wurzel Gummidge was always an acting highlight for Pertwee. Indeed, he loved the original stories when he was a child and had listened to the radio series after the war. The show lasted four series in its original format between 1979 and 1981, 30 episodes in total. There were many guest stars in the series, including Billy Connolly, Barbara Windsor, Bill Maynard, Joan Sims, Bernard Cribbins, and Pertwee's cousin, Bill Pertwee. There was one Christmas special entitled A Cup of Tea and a Slice of Cake, and Pertwee and Stubbs performed a musical version of the series in 1981 at the Birmingham Repertory Theatre. Two new series were commissioned by Television New Zealand, but only Pertwee and Stubbs agreed to fly across to film the episodes, 22 in total. Pertwee didn't like the scripts very much, but then again, Keith Waterhouse wasn't involved. What made Wurzel Gummidge so endearing? Pertwee had much to do with it. His ability to mix both extreme humour and pathos in one scene, and chaos and heartwarming love in another, reflected the personality of every child in the country. They could identify with him. Pertwee took the role to heart so much in one famous scene, he even cried real tears on cue. Before Wurzel Gummidge and towards the end of his Doctor Who days, Pertwee found it possible to appear in the movies a little bit more. His role in Against the Desert in 1973 is a bit obscure because it was never released. However, the year after he left Doctor Who, he had a role alongside Peter Ustinov, Helen Hayes, Derek Nimmo, Joan Sims, Bernard Breslau, Roy Kinnear and Derek Giler in Disney's successful movie One of Our Dinosaurs is Missing. More movies followed, including a remake of one of his favourites, Ask a Policeman, which had originally starred Will Hay, Graham Moffat and Maude Marriott. Pertwee would work with comic duo Cannon and Ball in a more sedate version called The Boys in Blue. Again, great character actors worked alongside Pertwee in the movie, including Jack Douglas, Eric Seitz and Roy Kinnear. Never a patch on the original movie, it endures today as a light family film. Of course, Pertwee played in some of the greatest British comedy films, the Carry On movies. Pertwee appeared in Cleo in 1964, Screaming in 1966, Cowboy in 1966 and Columbus in 1992. However, he thought he was being offered a part in a serious movie with the last one and was slightly deflated when he found himself in another Carry On. Although he always seemed a little embarrassed about being in Carry On films during an interview, he took his cameo parts extremely well in all of them, playing alongside the likes of Sid James, Kenneth Williams, Jim Dale, Harry H. Corbett, Charles Hawtrey, Joan Sims, the list goes on and on. On 20th of March 1994, Pertwee fell foul of Noel Edmonds on his Saturday night house party by receiving a Gotcha award. A Gotcha was a spoof award given to a celebrity by Noel in some embarrassing predicament without their knowing that they were being set up and secretly filmed. Pertwee's setup involved his taking part in a spoof radio show in which he was meant to pass comment about his favourite music. However, the wrong music was played. Spoof callers, part of a live phone-in, inadvertently insulted him and the studio started leaking water. The endearing thing about Pertwee's Gotcha was how amiable he was throughout. When Noel turned up at the very end, Pertwee was oblivious to the fact that he had been set up and was very pleased to see him. The whole piece, slightly shy of 10 minutes in length, is a delightful insight into Jon Pertwee, the man, indeed. He appears not as grumpy as he sometimes made out to be. Pertwee's last TV appearance was on Cilla Black's Surprise Surprise, in which he appeared in costume as the Doctor to present a small boy with a life-sized Dalek. Again, he is the endearing elder statesman who can still perform for his audience, especially its starry-eyed youngsters. Jon Pertwee died in his sleep of a heart attack. It was on holiday at Timberlake, Connecticut, with his wife, taking a break from his one-man show, Who is Jon Pertwee? He was 76. Following instructions in his will, Jon was cremated with an effigy of Wurzel Gummidge attached to his coffin. Pertwee managed the first great transition for Doctor Who, taking the programme into colour TV, giving more insight into the Doctor's own race of Time Lords and bringing in more adult content. To many people, Pertwee is the definitive Doctor, embodying the lust for adventure and serious intent that was at the very heart of the show, and is still prevalent today in the new series, as Tom Baker, who considered Pertwee a friend, qualifies. I was a great admirer of such a stylish actor. He was not only a great performer, but he was so good to work with. He made everyone feel at home. In November 1982, Pertwee summed up his interpretation of the Doctor against the backdrop of his whole career quite succinctly. The impact it made on my career was immense. I saw the Doctor as an interplanetary crusader, and it was this dashing Pied Piper image that appealed to me. I could spread my cloak, take the Earth under my wing and say, "It's all right now, I'll deal with this." So there we have it, Jon Pertwee, the third Doctor. For me, I love Jon Pertwee's Doctor. I really did enjoy the way that he took the role and took the character. And as it says in the book, as the author says, he added more to the character, and he continued to bring it forward. You know, we'd started off with Hartnell's Doctor, who was the more thoughtful, who brought the more thoughtful side to the Doctor, you know, kind of that harshness side to him as well, and that strict kind of regime that he had. Then we had Patrick Troughton, who brought in the sort of comedy effect, the sort of playful side of the Doctor. And then Jon Pertwee added the physical side of the Doctor, you know, a lot more energy, you know, a lot more action, getting involved a lot more. And for me, those first three Doctors put together is what the Doctor is nowadays. You know, you can see all that in Eccleston's Doctor, in David Tennant's, and especially in Matt Smith's Doctor. You know, I think those first three actors really sort of set up the role and the character of the Doctor that we see today. And as it says there, you know, Pertwee added so much and brought it forward with obviously finding out more of the Doctor's history, of where he came from. I think it was sort of the real, I know it might sound weird, but the real start and the real origins of the Doctor that we know today. I mean, the first episode that I saw of Jon Pertwee's was actually his first one, Spearhead from Space, and it was quite early on when I was getting into Doctor Who as well. I mean, the first episode I ever watched was Tom Baker, and I think Spearhead from Space was probably sort of one of the third or fourth episodes I actually saw. And I mean, as a kid, the Autons were really scary. You know, even looking back now, I mean, the fact that, you know, they brought them back in the new series shows kind of what a fearful sort of enemy that they were. But I remember, so obviously, again, as a youngster, you know, I was introduced to Tom Baker first and then seeing Jon Pertwee do it, so I was going backwards. But I remember just loving how different he was. And I think there was a scene where he was doing facial expressions in the mirror just after he'd come round in hospital, and there was just something about him. And you know, again, he sort of started off as quite abrasive, quite an abrupt kind of character, kind of coming across a bit arrogant when sort of dealing with humans as such. And you know, he was clearly you know, he made it quite clear that he was the brainy one, and he knew what he was on about, sort of talking to scientists and whatnot. But you know, he was, again, he sort of added a colourful kind of thing. You know, he always had that cape that he kind of went around in. Bessie, beloved Bessie, you know, you had to love Bessie. And like I say, all the physical side that he added to it, you know, we hadn't seen much fighting from Troughton and Hartnell's Doctor, but Jon Pertwee really did sort of tackle all the monsters and the aliens head on. You know, he was very much a fan of the of Aikido, and he brought that into Doctor Who. And it was just a sort of around the time of sort of Superman and Batman films that are around on TV and in the cinemas. It was kind of bringing that kind of style into Doctor Who around that time, and giving it that kind of, you know, Biff Pow kind of feel to it, which, you know, in the early 70s I think kind of worked a little bit more, and it's something that we haven't seen too much of in some of the other Doctors. I think Pertwee was probably one of the most hands-on Doctors that we've seen, really. And I mean, unfortunately, I haven't seen as many Pertwee episodes as I'd liked. I mean, I'm hoping to change that pretty soon. But yeah, I didn't see too many. Like, I haven't managed to see that interaction with the Master that you know, the author talks about in there. I mean, I've only managed to see little clips, but Roger Delgado as that first Master. Although, you know, we've had some fantastic Masters since, and for me, Anthony Ainley was kind of the best. But Roger Delgado's, the look of him was just so spot on. I mean, it says it there, you know, he had that proper evil sort of look about him. And it is unfortunate that, you know, what happened, and, you know, he died when he did. You know, it would have been interesting to see how they would have tied everything up there with that storyline, and see what direction they would have taken that story. So, you know, it's a real tragedy what happened there, and it obviously had quite an effect on Jon Pertwee as well, who I think was well known for saying he didn't believe, you know, he didn't really want to carry on if you know, without Delgado being there, he didn't think it could work properly. So one thing I love about Jon Pertwee is there's so many clips of him talking and a lot of interviews that you can see on YouTube, and you can just see from him how much he loved doing that job and being the Doctor, and the fact that he clearly kept up that character for the rest of his life, really, you know, up until the day that he died. You know, he was always happy to go to the conventions and meet the fans, and being that character, you know, performing with some of the other doctors. He had a fantastic relationship with Patrick Troughton. That, you know, they always, in the anniversary episodes, they always sort of had this hatred for each other. Well, not hatred. They kind of disliked each other a little bit, and they always kept that character whenever they were at conventions and in interviews, which I always thought was really good, you know, for fans to see that, because I mean they were best of friends, you know, away from the character and everything. So it was always nice to see that. But yeah, you can just see in the way he speaks about it, he was obviously very proud of it, very proud of the success that it that created, and, you know, loved entertaining people and entertaining the kids. But also I think it, as it says in there, you know, it brought a more adult feel to it. And I think it did bring a different generation of fans to Doctor Who, and it took it away from people considering it just to be a kids' TV show. I mean, you see, you still have people these days calling it a kids' TV show, which always gets me really angry, but I'm not going to go into that now. But I think Pertwee's Doctor really brought it forward in that sense, in bringing adults into it a little bit more. One of my favourite performances of Pertwee was in the anniversary episode of The Five Doctors. You know, seeing him paired up with Sarah Jane again, even Bessie making an appearance, and with the Master and the other Doctors. I mean, that episode in general is one of my favourites. It's such a fantastic one. But for me, Pertwee kind of stole that one for me. I really enjoyed his performance in that. And it just sort of went to show that even years after leaving it, leaving the show, he could just get back into that character so quickly, you know, without any effort really. And it just showed what a great, I mean, the amount of things that he did in his career, you know, not just Doctor Who, he had such a fantastic career. And as it says in there, he's clearly one of the best character actors that, you know, we've ever produced from this country. Again, alongside Patrick Troughton, really. And he's gone down as one of the greats, and quite rightly so. So that's Jon Pertwee, the Third Doctor, and a top Doctor as well. So, yeah, leave me your thoughts, guys. If he was your Doctor, if you grew up watching him, if you, you know, like me, you're a bit younger and you've watched the episodes back and still think he was a great Doctor, then leave me your thoughts on him below in the comments, or at my Twitter at ChrisJonesLUFC. So that's the Third Doctor done with. On to the Fourth Doctor next, and it's my favourite, it's Tom Baker, so really looking forward to that one, guys. Hope you can join me for that one, but until then, as always, thank you for watching, and I'll see you all very soon.